The Subversive Copy Editor, Advice from Chicago, or How to Negotiate Good Relationships with Your Writers, Your Colleagues, and Yourself, Second Edition, by Carol Fisher Saller, narrated by Pamela Almand. This version of the Subversive Copy Editor, Second Edition, has been lightly edited in places to better serve the audio format. Introduction. I hear you. As the editor of the Chicago Manual of Style Online's monthly Chicago Style Q&A, I've been handling readers' questions about writing style since the University of Chicago Press launched the Q&A in 1997. That amounts to tens of thousands of queries from students, professors, copy editors, business people, and others who struggle as they write and edit. As of this writing, the Chicago Manual of Style Online receives more than 1 million page views per month. Fortunately for us, most visitors do not submit questions to the Q&A. The Chicago Manual of Style, for the uninitiated, is one of the English-speaking world's most revered style manuals. Although Chicago Style may not have the most users, it surely has the most devoted. From its beginnings in the 1890s as a simple in-house sheet of proofreading tips for manuscript editors at the University of Chicago Press, to its current online, print, and mobile-optimized editions, it has grown into a Bible for writers and editors in almost every kind of writing outside journalism, where Associated Press style and New York Times style dominate. Written by the Manuscript Editing Department at the University of Chicago Press, the Chicago Manual of Style, CMOS, has advice on everything from punctuation and capitalization to mathematics and diacritics. Its chapters on the styling of note and bibliography citations have been adopted by universities around the world. Users of CMOS include the most impossibly learned writers and editors, as well as the most clueless. And for nearly 20 years, the monthly Q&A has played host to them all. Reading the questions that come through the site is a daily adventure away from editing tasks. We answer as many as we can, and I choose the best ones for the monthly posting. The range of topics can be startling. Here's a note we received from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory at NASA. Question. Dear Chicago Manual of Style Q&A person, what is the rule for sequencing adjectives in a series? For example, we know that numbers come before size indicators, e.g. 6 small apples. We also know that colors come after size indicators, e.g. 6 small yellow apples. The specific problem is whether to say narrow anticyclonically dominated northwestern coast or anticyclonically dominated narrow northwestern coast. Please don't say the correct answer is anticyclonically dominated northwestern narrow coast. And their kicker ending, what is the rule that supports your answer? After consulting a linguist, we replied, our consultant was somewhat hesitant to comment without a fuller context to work with, suspecting that this may be a sentence-level issue and not an adjective-phrase-level issue. He pointed out that sequencing can vary for reasons of emphasis, and that without having the context, he couldn't discern the intended emphasis. If narrow is the emphasis, then it should come first, followed by a comma. If anticyclonically dominated is the emphasis, then it should come first, followed by a comma. In contrast, another rather dreamy-sounding note read simply, Dear CMOS, what is Chicago style? Could you give an example? And one of my favorites, Would rats die if they drink soda? Questions come from all over the world, some from readers who struggle with English. Their grammar questions go deep and are sometimes beyond our ability to respond. Please tell differences of at and to. One day this came in. Question. Hello. I wonder how I can cite the Korean Constitutional Court case. The CMOS, as far as I've searched, does not provide a clear tip on it, although it spent many pages on the citation rule of U.S., Canadian, and European court cases. As an illustration, how can I cite and what followed was a long string of Korean that I was helpless to decipher. Recently, I learned that a Chinese translation of the 16th edition of the manual has been published. I wonder what kinds of questions we'll receive once its readers discover the Q&A. Most of the messages I read, however, are basic questions about style. Often I know the answer, but sometimes I have to look it up. Or I email my colleagues for a quick consensus. Or I run around and ask the first two or three editors I can find. Although people outside the press call us style goddesses and assume we are experts on everything in the manual, most of the time I feel more like the pathetic little person behind the curtain in The Wizard of Oz. It's only because I'm surrounded and protected by knowledgeable and generous co-workers that I can assemble the authoritative front that appears in the Q&A. When I get an esoteric question involving technical writing or linguistics, I can phone or email one of the professors on campus for help. Other times, I can do an internet search and point the reader to a more relevant site. For the most frequently asked questions, I keep template replies that I can personalize. I can't count the number of times we've been asked whether to type one space or two at the end of a sentence. It's one. Or how to cite a tweet. This doesn't worry me as much as it used to. The monthly postings to the Q&A that I cull from all these exchanges are always read by our managing editor and at least two other colleagues, who check my grammar and punctuation and tactfully set me straight when something is wrong. These days, two categories of questions seem to make up the bulk of the mail. The first type comes from those urgently seeking advice on a writing or an editing issue. Question: how do I cite a phone conversation with an anonymous caller? Question: how do you make a proper name and its acronym possessive? The district attorney, DA's, argument. Question: CMOS lowercases prepositions in book titles, but what if it's a really long one, like concerning? The second type of question comes from readers who want us to settle an argument. In these questions, I hear a persistent cry of frustration. Question: I know I'm right about something. Could CMOS please confirm it? Question: I know I'm right about something. Could you please set my husband, teacher, student, author, colleague, boss, editor straight? Question: I know I'm right about something. Could you please save the world from its slide into illiteracy? Questions like these inspired me to write this book for all of you, for students, professors, copy editors, business people, and writers who are sometimes dogged by indecision or confusion over rules of style and grammar, for those who know the rules but agonize over when or whether to apply them, for those who copy edit for a living and those who don't, and those who would like to. In the following chapters, I hope to soothe and encourage and lend power. I am not going to do this, however, by setting your teacher, student, author, colleague, boss, editor straight. And I'm not going to help with your homework. You won't learn the fundamentals of copy editing from me. Rather, consider this a relationship book, because I'm going to talk about the main relationships in your work life, with the writer, with your colleagues, and with yourself, in ways that you might not have considered before. Ways that might be called subversive. Right away, I should explain what I do not mean by a subversive copy editor, in case anyone has in mind a character like the one my former colleague Joe Weintraub once described in a prize-winning short story. In the story, a snooty language expert named Ezra Peckinpah has been tormented for months by a copy editor who purposely inserts errors into his column at the final stage before printing. In this scene, Ezra has just received the latest issue. He held the issue up to the light as if he were inspecting the texture of the paper itself for flaws, and when he found himself beginning the final paragraph with the ungrammatical apostrophe, "just between you, dear reader, and I," his arms twitched outward, his elbow striking his reading lamp so that it tottered on its base and almost toppled to the floor. "Galleys," he screamed into the telephone. "I demand to see galleys." No, at the risk of disappointing my more...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.